So there is a huge salt mine underneath Detroit, Michigan, and many people have no idea, even though it's been active for more than 100 years. Here's where all that salt came from, and how engineers stopped the Motor City from collapsing into the underworld. It's story time. Right now, I'm in Allen Park on a very windy day, and almost a quarter mile underneath my feet is the Detroit Salt Mine. It starts in southwest Detroit and includes more than 100 miles of tunnels and more than 2 square miles of the city and its nearby suburbs. So it's huge. But before I get much further, I should say that I did not get to go in. I've actually been holding off on making this video in hopes that I would meet someone who would know someone who would let me in, and so far, no dice. But I still think it's a story worth telling, because many of the people who live and drive above the mine, including on the major freeways right behind me, have no idea it's down there. Hey there, hi from the future. So after I filmed like 95% of this video, I found something really cool on eBay, which is this. This is an info pamphlet all about the Detroit Salt Mine, published in, I think, the early 1970s. It was published by the company that owned the mine at the time, which was the International Salt Company, and it contains a ton of really cool photos that I will be showing off for the rest of this video. The pamphlet also came with something I was so excited about, which was 3 pieces of salt from the Detroit Salt Mine. Okay, I'm gonna talk about the history and the geology and the engineering now, but you will be seeing all of these things make an appearance, and there's some context. The Detroit Salt Mine started in 1906, and since then, it's produced more than 45 million tons of salt. And the real number is probably much higher. The mine is still open, but the most recent stat I could find was from 2003. In any case, that's a lot of salt, and I wanted to understand where it came from. I associate salt with the ocean, but it turns out this state, famously surrounded by fresh water, is one of the top salt-producing states in the country because of this. This is a bedrock map. Basically, it shows what layer of rock you would hit if you went outside and dug through all the soil and gravel. And you'll notice that the bedrock layers covering most of Michigan form a giant bullseye. This is the Michigan Basin, and it represents, well, an ancient basin. It's a place where seas came and went over hundreds of millions of years. And there's some cool geology here. If you'd ever be interested in like a Michigan Basin tour video, please do let me know in the comments. For now, we'll pick up the story of the Michigan Basin around 420 to 440 million years ago. For context, because I always need context, the biggest land animals at this time were spider and millipede-like insects. So this was way before dinosaurs. According to a paper I read, the thinking is that the Michigan Basin at this time was fairly dry and was separated from the ocean by a band of rocks and reefs. Whenever the local sea levels went up, ocean water would pour into this basin. Then, when sea levels went down and the basin was separated from the ocean once again, that water would evaporate, leaving behind salt. And the idea is, this happened over and over and over again until we were left with some pretty serious salt deposits. Now, 400 some odd million years ago is a very long time ago, so these salt layers are long since buried. Like in Detroit, they're mining a specific layer called the Salina F unit, and it's almost 1,200 feet underground, or about a quarter mile. Also, as an aside, something I find just deeply fascinating is in the Detroit salt mine, they found little bits of fluid in the salt, and scientists think those fluids are trapped seawater from more than 400 million years ago. Based on studies of that liquid, they think the local oceans back then had less sodium and more calcium. And I kind of wonder what that would have tasted like. Like, do calcium salts taste different? I don't know. Okay, end aside. Now, mining in Michigan, even getting down to about 1,200 feet, where that salt layer is not unheard of. But that doesn't mean they had an easy job in Detroit.
In 1906, the Detroit Salt and Manufacturing Company started digging a hole in the ground. And this would turn out to be such a challenge that the company would go bankrupt before ever hitting salt. For one, they had to get through hundreds of feet of bedrock, plus boulders and sediment left behind from the glaciers thousands of years ago. And if you've ever tried to dig a really deep hole at the beach, you've gotten a little taste of what they had to deal with. Some of what they dug through had the consistency of quicksand, and it seemed like there was always water coming into the mine shaft. The engineer directing the project estimated that at one point, water was coming in at some 2 million gallons a minute, which seems like a lot of water, so I don't know how good that estimate is, but that's what he said. And to make matters worse, and so much worse than any of your beach waterworks projects, some of this water also contained hydrogen sulfide gas, which is flammable, smells terrible, and is also super toxic. "It attacked your eyes," one worker reported. "I can remember the men walking up and down the street crying. Some of them were even blinded for a while." But despite the gas and running out of money and several men being killed during construction, the project pressed on. The company reorganized, and by 1910 or 11, they had reached the layer of fairly pure salt that's still being mined today. By 1914, the mine was hauling out some 8,000 tons of rock salt every month, mostly for the leather and food processing industries. But except for maybe a few years at the beginning, they were not mining this stuff by hand. Salt is incredibly hard, and going at it with a pickaxe is almost a waste of time. So for many years, they did the next best thing. They loaded up a wall of the mine with explosives and blasted off hundreds of tons of salt at a time, underneath a major metropolitan area. According to an info packet from the 70s, the mine is deep enough that there was never any damage at the surface from these explosions. And actually, there's never been a cave-in at the Detroit salt mine at all. But over on Reddit, I did see people sharing that they or their family members remember feeling the rumble when the explosions went off, which seems disconcerting. Now, to be clear, I was able to get in touch with someone at the mine, and they clarified that they are not blowing things up anymore. Best mining practices have changed. Instead, today, they use machines that continuously claw away at the rock. What I think is interesting, though, is that these mine shafts, plural, because they did get a second one in the 1920s, these mine shafts aren't actually big enough to handle these huge pieces of equipment. So even today, most machinery has to be taken apart at the surface, moved into the mine, and then reassembled in the mine's underground machine shop. And now that I've said that, I find myself wondering if they void the warranty on most things they buy by, like, chopping them to bits. Anyway. Now, because the layer of salt they're mining is not terribly tall, the mine is basically one big floor, as opposed to having multiple levels. But here's the thing. It covers more than 2 square miles, with like freeways and neighborhoods and industrial buildings on top. So how do they keep it stable? Well, I learned that they use the room and pillar method. This is where rooms are carved out of the rock and huge pillars are left behind for support. I've seen different estimates as to exactly how big the rooms are, but it seems like they vary from about 30 to 60 feet across and about 20 to 40 feet high. So pretty roomy. Meanwhile, the pillars are around 60 by 80 feet, aka the size of buildings. In fact, I've gotten the impression that these rooms and pillars make the mine feel like a salt city. I mean, the walls are salt, the floor is salt, they leave some behind for purity reasons, and for stability, the ceiling is another several feet of salt. I even found a photo of an old office building made entirely out of, you guessed it, salt. According to the company website, after all this salt is mined, it's mostly processed underground and can even be stored down there before being hauled up to the surface. And what's it for? As of 2017, the mine was producing about 1.7 million tons of salt per year. and it's used on the roads and for other ice melting jobs. In fact, Detroit is often given credit for being one of the first cities in the US to start salting its roads, because they just had so much of the stuff.
Now, unfortunately, the odds of me ever getting closer to the mine than this are slim. For most of the 80s and 90s, the mine was closed for business and open for tours. But these days, for safety and to not interrupt production, they don't really let people down there. Nonetheless, I find it fascinating that all of this happens underneath a major metropolitan area. Every day, thousands of people drive over the mine, and in the winter, they commute on roads sprinkled with its 400 million year old salt. And many have no idea, but now you do. And for all of you who are working down there, keep up the good work. If you enjoy stories like this, please feel free to subscribe and follow along, but either way, thanks for being here. I hope you learned something that makes you think about the world just a little differently, and I'll see you soon.